I wanted to talk about like the Bible passage we just read. The Bible passage of today talks about forsaking everything you have, your father, mother, children, wealth, and what riches, and what is riches? What exactly do we call riches? And in this case, or in this context, we're looking at riches would be anything you have, anything where your heart is. In Matthew 6:21, thank you. So where your treasure is, that's where your heart will be. So if your heart is in, if you put your treasures in money, if money is your treasure, that's where your heart is. If you put your treasures in property, in material things, that's where your heart would be. If you put your treasures also in people, that's where your heart would be. But your treasures should always, your riches should always reside in the Lord. Your riches should be in the Lord. So that is where your heart too should be. Moving straight into the outlines of today. Oh no, sorry. Lesson introduction. Being a disciple of Jesus involves a process of divine making, which also commands an ultimate commitment to follow him. And he said to them all, "If any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me." Luke 9:23. This involves leaving all behind through the leading of the Holy Spirit and obedience to following Christ daily. You cannot just follow Christ today and leave him tomorrow. There's this thing that one of my French teachers told me when I was in junior school. She was like, if you abandon French for a day, French will abandon you for the whole week. So, and that's actually very relatable to the Word of God. If you leave the Word of God to only Sunday, you wouldn't even remember what you learned last week Sunday, talk less of having to know what the Word of God really says. So we should take the Word of God daily. It should be your food daily, not just anytime you feel like, oh, let me go and seek God today, let me seek God tomorrow. You have to seek God every day, read the Word of God every day. Also, following Christ should be a commitment you make every day. God is only committed to those who are committed to following Christ at all costs. At all costs is not only when times are good, you want to follow Christ, not only when, you don't only seek God when you're in distress, you also seek him when you're, when times are good, when nothing is, when everything is going well, you also seek God. When everything is going not as they should, you also seek God. So seek God at all costs. Be it whether you're being persecuted, you're being attacked, still keep your mind on Christ himself, on the goal. You should have a goal and you should make your goal very clear. So at all costs, you should seek Christ. Those who have made up their minds to go all the way with Jesus and grow in him in all things and unto the fullness of his person. Colossians 2, 9 to 10. I just want to read quickly. Colossians 2, 9 to 10, Ephesians 4, 13, and Ephesians 3, 17 to 19. I'm just going to read it very quickly. Colossians 2, 9 to 10, for in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in him who is the head of all principalities and power. Till we all come to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. That is Ephesians 4:13, and then Ephesians 3:17 to 19. That Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and depth and height, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you will be filled with the fullness of God. Praise the Lord. Okay, now the lesson outline number one is voluntary discipleship. What do we mean by voluntary discipleship? Can anybody help us, please?
Following God at your own will, not what you're forced to do, or what, not what you're told to do, but like what you know you should do, and what, yeah.
Thank you. Can we put a round of applause for her? So voluntary discipleship is not a forced thing. Nobody forces you to do it. You have to, on your own, decide you want to be committed to Christ. You have to, on your own, decide where you want to go, who you want to stand for. So Jesus knew that no one could come to God except through him. Yet he did not threaten or force his disciples to follow him. If we look at the example of the story of Nicodemus, Nicodemus asked Jesus, Master, what must I do to enter the kingdom of heaven? And Jesus told him, you have to be born again. And what does being born again mean? What do you understand by being born again? You have to, on your own, decide you want to live the life you're currently, if you're there, you have to decide you would take that step to leave that environment, to go into the kingdom of God and live holy, consciously, on a daily basis, walk towards Christ. If any man will come after me, let him deny himself take up his cross and follow me daily. Pastors and leaders should only expose their church members and followers every opportunity to become true disciples and grow in Christ. They should not take advantage of them for personal gain, such as increasing membership or finances. To voluntarily follow Christ involves the following. The first one is the conviction backed up by response. Jesus did not commit himself to the disciples. They chose to believe and follow him because they had the conviction through his deeds. John 2:23-25. So the disciples saw who God is. He saw who Jesus is. And they decided to, through his deeds, they followed him. Another thing is that we have to be pure and genuine in following Christ. It has to come from your heart. It should not be, oh, I'm trying to please this person, let me act like this. One thing I've realized about that is it doesn't last long. At a point, you just get tired because you're not doing it for the right reasons. You're doing it to please somebody else. And that's not why you should be following. You can take it as a start. Okay, this person wants me to, let me just start. But at a point, you realize it should be out of your own conviction, your own, from your heart, that is where following Christ should come from. Praise the Lord. Another step would be peculiar commitment to following Jesus, as shown by Peter in John 21:15-25. When the disciples went back to fishing and Jesus called them, Jesus went to meet them. And then when they realized it was Jesus, they came back to the shore. And then Jesus told Peter to follow him. And at that point, Peter understood what Jesus was talking about. You're not only going to do the things which I say you would do, or even greater things that I have done, but you would also be persecuted as I have been persecuted as well. And that's another thing we have to take into consideration as being disciples of Christ. It's not always going to be rosy. Yes, you're going to have good times. You're going to have times where you feel up, but at the same time, you're also going to be persecuted. They persecuted prophets, they persecuted Jesus, they would also persecute you. because you're not of this world, you cannot be accepted by the world. Another thing is keep following Jesus at his pace. The example of Thomas, John 20:19-20 and 24-29, where Thomas refused to believe until he saw Jesus, until he put his hands or his fingers into the hole made by the nails and Jesus' side. But we should remember not to walk in at our own pace or the pace of someone else. You have to walk by the pace of Jesus, walk with the pace of the Holy Spirit. And if your pace is to walk, if you're in a group and your pace is to walk slow, God has said, this is the pace which I want you to walk in. You have to walk in that pace, regardless of if the person beside you is growing as fast as you can even imagine. That is not your pace. And if you try to keep up, you might fall and get back to the position where you cannot even stand up. A voluntary decision not based on assumptions. Ruth, in the book of Ruth 1:16-18, Elisha, 1 Kings 19:19-21, and Matthew, in Matthew 9:9, and Peter in Mark 10:28, and Luke 5:1-11. So Ruth told Naomi, and she said, I will follow you wherever you go. Your God will be my God. Whatever, where you die, I will die. So at that point, she understood Naomi's God, if I should put it in that those words. She understood him, and then she decided to follow God for herself. We've also learned their God, your God, and then my God. You have to get to a point where you know God for yourself. You have to know God for yourself. And then Elisha too, he saw Elijah, and Elijah threw his mantle on him, and then he decided to follow Elijah. And at the end, Elijah understood the God Elijah was following, and he, from his heart, he willingly dedicated everything. He left all he had to follow God, to follow Christ. It should be a conscious, non-coercive choice that gives the right to withdraw at any time if they wish. If they wish to, John 6:59-70. If you bring someone to Christ, discipleship is not if by force something, as we've mentioned. Okay, discipleship is not a by force something. If they decide to withdraw at any point in time, they are free to. It's, you can't force them to stay. Okay. Lesson outline 2, spiritual mentorship. There are mature believers in Christ who can model the life of Christ to follow, for others to follow. They have gone ahead to watch over the growth and development of many others in Christ. They have no selfish ambition to manipulate others. They are helpers on our journey to following Christ, who are to connect us to God directly for the purpose of becoming like Jesus. Galatians 4:1-2. They do not enslave you, but they teach you to become like Christ. They teach you to know Christ for yourself. John provided guidance to the people. John 1:19-37, where his message was all about the coming of Christ. He was the forerunner of Christ. The disciples followed Jesus and learned from him directly. Matthew 4:18-23. Submission to God's chosen spiritual mentors for us to aid the process of our growth in the character of Christ. Galatians 4:1-2. Luke 6:40. Paul and Silas also mentored Timothy in Acts 16:1-5. It is especially important that we allow the Holy Spirit to confirm in our hearts God's chosen people for spiritual life oversight. Once confirmed, we are to be fully persuaded and follow them as God's under shepherds for our lives. Romans 14:5-8. Only true disciples of Jesus can make disciples for Jesus. So you cannot be in the kingdom of darkness and expect to bring somebody to Christ. And just quickly, lesson outline 3, obedience in discipleship. The focal point of following Jesus is learning to obey God daily in his details, his words, instructions, through other means, his ways, and his will. John 10:27-30. When God speaks, you listen to what God says. Follow it at every word he says. If he says go left, go left. If he says go right, go right. This entails deliberate attention to every detail that will make us to be progressively transformed into his likeness as we learn to walk with him daily. The knowledge of Christ increases in us as we learn to obey him in everything. Matthew 28:16-20, 2 Peter 3:11-18. Obedience helps us to respond to God's grace in faith. Romans 1:5. When men and women in discipleship learn simple obedience to authorities, it forms the basis for total obedience to God and a basis for following Jesus. Romans 13:1-2. Obedience is a personal conviction that determines our speed as we progress with God. God will always allow us to choose if we want to obey him and obey those bearing oversight over our lives. Those who absolutely love God are always ready to obey him in all things. Our spiritual progress is hindered when we choose not to obey. Our daily prayer must be, Lord, teach me from my heart to say, your will be done. My God, my Father, while I stray. By Charlotte Elliott. Okay, so quickly, let's just touch a few class activities. I'll just take like one or two people, if anybody can discuss when discipleship relationship can turn into an abuse, like when you're being discipled by somebody or the relationship you have just turned to an abuse. Can somebody like just talk about it a little bit?
I would say one of the cases could be when the person discipling you, instead of teaching you and, you know, nurturing you, uses you as a medium of, uses extortion to get money from you, basically. Begins to extort money from you, extort your resources, basically teaches you ways to please him and not God. So basically telling you that, okay, you should give your all to him and not God. That means your resources, your money and everything. I would say that's a state of abuse.
Yes, can we put our hands together for him, please? Thank you so much. Because of time, another thing is, if you're in a position where you are being discipled, you're being taught the word of God, or you're being led to see the path of Christ, you have to, like I said, know Christ for yourself. You have the word of God. Gone are the days when you have to go to the temple to listen, to hear the word of God. You have the word of God in your, we all have our Bibles. So if what your mentor, spiritual leader is telling you is not in line with the word of God, you have to question that, because you're not supposed to be taught anything the word has not been given or has not said. So you always have to align everything with the word of God and compare it. It's like the saying, do what I say but don't do what I do. I'm telling you to do this but I'm doing the other thing. I'm telling you to follow Christ, but every day I'm at the club doing only what God knows. So it's, even as mentors, as leaders, we should not only focus our mind on what I'm preaching. Your lifestyle too is a word, is a message. So your lifestyle as well has to be able to preach to back up what you preach. Praise the Lord. And can we give any practical examples as to when it is right to stop following a leader? Just one person, please. Any practical example as to when it is right to stop following a leader? Yes, we have to.
Maybe when you're seeing what the person is saying or what the person is doing that is not what is in the Bible. For example, what is in the Bible, or maybe you're seeing what the person is doing is different from what the person is saying that is in the Bible.
Yes. So. Thank you.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
In addition to that, we had a story one time. I don't think it happens in this part of the world, but in Africa, we had a story of a man of God that told his followers to bend down like goats to eat grasses. So that kind of a thing, when it gets to that point where somebody wants to debase you, I hope that is the right word. And because God created us as higher animals, we are not goats. We are human beings. We are not meant to fit that way. Whenever you notice that kind of debasing or debasement, you should run. I think you should put a stop. I don't expect anybody to continue to be in that church where that person is the leader. Like that man, he told them to even drink fuel, to eat grasses. So, yeah, it may not happen here, but spiritually, there may be some instances like that. So we just have to be on the watch. When it gets to that, you just have to run away. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Thank you so much, sir. And yes, everything has been said. And just of last class activity is to talk about the kind of obedience Jesus manifested when he was a man like us. Does anybody want to give that a go? Just very quickly, yes, please.
One of the obedience, the basic one, is coming down to the earth to die for us. Even if he didn't want to, he knew that the pain that was coming was beyond what a human being could possibly bear. But he still said, nevertheless, your will be done. So that's something.
Thank you very much. Also, in line to that, he was very obedient to the Spirit when the Spirit led him into the wilderness and everything, even obedient to his parents, to the authorities, and to God as well. Like, that was the whole reason he was on earth. He was very obedient to God. So in summary, Jesus is our perfect example to follow. For to this you were called, because Christ also suffered like us, leaving us an example that you should follow in his footsteps. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 21. And following Jesus is an unconditional surrender to God in all areas. Believers should be encouraged to pray, trust the Holy Spirit to lead them to follow the right mentors that will guide them in following Jesus the right way. Consistency and continuity in reading the Word of God are key to following Jesus and being his disciples indeed. Amen. Shall we just bow our heads for prayer? Father, we thank you for today. We praise you. We give you all the honor and adoration. We thank you, Lord, for your word that you have given us today. We pray, dear Lord Almighty, that as we go, let your word stay and abide in us in Jesus' name. Continue to teach us, O Lord, everything that was not said and everything that was said in line with your Spirit,